Hello everyone, and welcome to this side event, Ratcheting the Integrity of Net Zero Commitments to Unlock Ambition Loops and Regain Climate Momentum. Now, if you're wondering why we chose that title, it's because the UN Climate Convention announced an award for the longest side event title at COP28. So we decided to enter, and they also had a bonus category for the biggest number of buzz phrases that anyone could get in the title of a side event. So I think we've probably swept the board with that. There is a more serious reason, which I'll come to in a minute. Anyway, a few introductions first. My name's Richard Black. I'm a senior associate with the Energy and Climate Intelligence Unit based in the UK, one of the founders of the Net Zero Tracker. And you'll hear a lot more from our distinguished panelists in a minute, but just for a brief introduction in the order from me, we have next to me Camilla Hislop, who's from the University of Oxford, Dr. Takeshi Kuramochi from NewClimate Institute based in Cologne, Dr. Kaihui Song from Data-Driven Enviro Lab in North Carolina, Dr. Alina Averchenkova from the Grantham Institute at the London School of Economics in London, Dr. Todd Edwards, who's the tracking and recognition leader within the UN Climate Convention, and also speaking, but sadly we're out of spaces on the panel, is Emily Faint, who heads the all the net zero policy work at the British Standards Institute, and therefore the standards work that's going on in standards institutes around the world. So, seriously, why the title? Because actually ambition loops is what it's all about in the net zero world. If net zero were a person, it would have started life in about sort of 2013-14 as a tiny little person in the body of the IPCC Fifth Assessment Report. And it gained a little badge of recognition when 2015 Sweden set a net zero emissions law. But it really wasn't till 2018 when it really got into elementary school, when actually the IPCC in the 1.5 special report talks about the necessity to get to net zero carbon emissions about mid-century in order to have an even chance of keeping to 1.5 Celsius, which roughly was reconfirmed-ish in the sixth assessment report that came out much more recently. So the net zero tracker itself has a even briefer history. We started 2019, and all we did then was basically track the pledges that countries had made. And I remember the first report we put out in 2019, when 16% of GDP, a mere 16%, was under net zero legislation, and now it's around about 90%. So since then, the net zero tracker itself has grown to a much bigger organisation. It now has the four, it's not an organisation, let's say a coalition, a collaboration, if you want, between Energy and Climate Intelligence Unit, Oxford University, NewClimate Institute, and Data-Driven Enviro Lab. But the whole kind of constellation of organisations and initiatives on it has also grown hugely. You have the UN itself, the UN Climate Convention itself, bringing in the accountability of net zero targets from non-state actors into this. We had the high-level group, the Secretary-General's high-level group last year, big recommendations on that, which is something in the tracker that we're sort of trying to align to, and all kinds of other accountability initiatives as well, philanthropists getting very interested in how we track all of this. So that's why we're here today, to have a look at this landscape, to see what it all amounts to, what the successes are, what we know, what we don't know, and what maybe needs to be done in order that we can actually do this better. So without further ado, let me hand over to our first panellist, Camilla Hislop from University of Oxford, who's the co-data lead at the Net Zero Tracker. And among the things that we've been doing is trying to sort of expand the number of things that we track in terms of what entities have actually promised. Because just to obviously to say you've got a net zero target isn't enough. That's so 2019, that's just gone. So we're way beyond that now. So Camilla, over to you.
Thanks, Richard. So I'm going to give you a whirlwind tour, wind being the operative word there, because the Net Zero Tracker really believes in tripling renewable energy. So we're going to take a whirlwind tour of the net zero standards. I'm just looking at Emily thinking standards. The net zero target setting across the global economy. And we're looking at countries, regions, cities, and companies, because that's what we look at the Net Zero Tracker. And at the tracker, we care about two things. We care about the quantity of net zero targets and the quality thereof. Now, tracking the quantity is very easy because we have a global cohort of very engaged and talented voluntary data contributors to whom I once again say my biggest thanks. But the quality is also becoming increasingly easy because we've seen in the last couple, in the last year, and Takeshi is going to talk a little bit more about this, convergence of what it means to have good net zero. So I can talk to you with some confidence on what the integrity of net zero targets looks like right now. And if I can change slide. The overall picture that we're seeing is that there has been some progress, but we still have a lot of hard work to do. So I'll take you through how we're doing at different levels, starting with the national. This is from the UN Environmental Programme's Emissions Gap Report, which the Net Zero Tracker contributed to. This is the high-income G20 members. The G20 makes up 3/4 of global emissions. So this is the group of emitters that we really care about. And you can see the green is great, the yellow is not so great, and the red's not good. And we've seen some progress. So here in the high-income groups, you can see that a lot of nations have embedded their net zero target in law, which, as Richard was mentioning, considering the brevity of net zero as a concept in the global kind of discourse, this is really quite incredible, I think. But we still have quite a long way to go. And you can really see this in the lower and upper middle income G20 members, particularly, for example, in carbon removal and in plans. So in particular, thinking about plans, many countries have a net zero target, but aren't very clear about how they're intending to get there. And this is mirrored across different groups. So this is not just countries, this is also subnational governments and corporates. So in June, we released our stocktake report, which takes stocktake of what net zero targets look like. And we measured how subnationals and corporates were doing against the UN Race to Zero's minimum starting line criteria. I'm sure we're all aware of what the Race to Zero is, but I love nothing more than being pompous. So the UN Race to Zero obviously convenes non-state actors who are committed to getting to net zero by 2050, and they have a minimum procedural requirements for joining. And so we checked how they were doing, and fewer than 5% of non-state actors meet the minimum criteria. So they're not even at the starting line. And this is also seen if we look at the UN expert group, which Richard mentioned. So you may have seen at COP27 that the UN expert group set out these 10 recommendations. We, at that time, were able to track 6. We are now signposting to influence maps so that you can understand aligning lobbying and advocacy, which are there at 6. And we've recently added a metric to be more in line with 5, which is the phasing out of fossil fuels. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. The idea being that in order to get to net zero, we need to be thinking about potentially phasing, phasing out fossil fuels. And so this is hot off the press. You may have seen this on Monday. We had a press release for our report because we've just added fossil fuel phase out commitments to our tracking of net zero commitments. And I'll just give you 2 kind of takeaways. The first is in production, we see very little evidence of phase out pledges. You can see that only 3 nations have, 3 nations have, 6 nations, I can't count, 6 nations have said that they will phase out coal production, which accounts for 5% of global coal production. This sounds terribly low until you consider oil and gas. Oil and gas, there are only 3 countries, which is Denmark, France, and Spain, that have pledged to phase out oil and gas production. That accounts for 0.12% of oil production and 0.08% of global gas production. We do see slightly more movement in use, particularly in coal. So you can see the leaders really are Europe, and the orange is where we've found that they are phasing out coal for electricity use, and there's really been quite a lot more movement here. So over a quarter of nations have agreed to phase out coal. You're probably looking at the US thinking, gosh, Camilla, you missed that. But what we were looking at in this report is unabated phase out. So that's what we found. The high level summary is we've done some things, but there's still a very long way to go. And I'm hoping Takeshi can expand a bit more on that.
Great, absolutely. Thank you so much, Camilla. Yes, so as Camilla was saying, different types of entity, and we find different things basically when you look shallowly and when you look deeply. And of course, the idea that there is a credibility gap in many net zero commitments has been made by the UN Secretary General, among many others. So Takeshi, you've spent quite a lot of time looking at this in different guises. Tell us all about the credibility gap.
Yes, thank you. I will go first a bit deeper into the robustness of corporate net zero targets. So in the last net zero stocktake report, we conducted a review of the publications on the corporate net zero targets and their integrity published since Glasgow Climate Conference. And this includes the UN's HSEC recommendations, ISO's net zero guidance, among others. And what we did here was to look at five key dimensions to ensure robustness of corporate net zero targets. First, coverage of emission scopes, then the frequency of interim targets, then 1.5 degree alignment of emission reduction targets and their transition plans, and last but not least, on the offsetting and the use of carbon dioxide removals. And for each of these dimensions, we looked at whether there is a convergence on the high-level principles and whether there's a convergence on the specific criteria to operationalize those principles. So what you can see here is that for the first two dimensions on the coverage of emission scopes and interval of interim targets, there's a high-level degree of agreement. On the emission scopes, all of these publications agree that the emission scopes 1 through 3. So scope 1 is the direct emissions, scope 2 is the electricity and heat consumption related emissions, and the scope 3 on the more broader indirect emissions. They should all be covered for to ensure robustness of corporate net zero pledges. And the same similar goes for the interim targets. They all agree that there should be interim targets for every 5 years or so, or even within shorter term. For the other three dimensions, the agreement is shown as moderate, but that does not mean there's a disagreement. Some of these studies that we reviewed do not take consideration of these dimensions, but those that provided recommendations, they're mostly in high agreement. And we looked at, for these three dimensions, there are also like subcategory or sub-considerations. These are all important. And for each of them, we made an assessment. And yeah, also looking at the specific criteria, there is emerging convergence. So this is a very good news. We see overall there's a convergence on the high-level principles, which is good news, encouraging. But they're still lacking on the specific criteria to make this operationable. So next steps will be to focus on this specific criteria development and convergence among various stakeholders and organizations. Now, we've been talking about sort of these robustness or integrity principles and kind of a checklist against which we can assess, you know, corporate or other emitters. But often these checklists misses some nuances or sometimes some insights that are not that will require deep calculations or deep analysis. In the Corporate Climate Responsibility Monitor report, which is conducted by NewClimate Institute and Carbon Market Watch, we look into the very details of their emission targets and what trying to quantify how much emission reductions they're trying to achieve within their value chain with their own reduction measures within the value chain. And we assessed 24 global major companies. And here we show that at the net zero target year, these companies are collectively, on average, committing to only 36% emission reductions from their respective base year. What happens to the remaining 64%? Either they're not covered by their targets, the emission sources, or they're relying on offset plans, or that the target, the net zero pledges are so vague that we cannot make any quantification. So this is very worrying, and this also highlights the need for very deep scrutiny to assess whether the companies or any non-state actors or national governments are committing to a 1.5 or Paris Agreement compatible climate action commitments. In addition to assessing or scrutinizing individual emitters and their climate action integrity, it is also important to look at the entire ecosystem of climate action accountability. So we published this paper called Climate Accountability Loop, where we looked at, we identified key conceptual functions of an accountability system. And then we looked at 27 initiatives that provide one of these functions and kind of mapped where what different initiatives are doing and in what way. So here we identify three core functions. First one is setting standards, guidance, and benchmarks. The second is ex-ante validation according to these standard guidance and benchmarks of the entity's targets. And the third one is ex-post verification to ensure that companies or any actors are making progress towards the targets that they set themselves. And then we also identified the supporting functions that that would enable these three core functions. What we find here through the assessment of 27 initiatives is that often these functions are performed by same initiatives without any effective institutional separation and independence. So from a governance point of view, this is somewhat problematic, and And the second point is that the expo verification of progress is virtually not performed in the current system. So these are two major issues that we identify for corporate climate action accountability. Based on the findings, we have made these recommendations, and we have submitted our documents to the UNFCCC Recognition and Accountability Framework so that these are properly taken into account. Thank you.
Lovely. Thanks very much, Takeshi. And we'll be hearing a lot more about that framework from Todd in a few moments. So just as the performance of corporates and national governments can be looked at, so can the performance of states and regions and cities as well. And here to tell us something about that, give us something of a status report, is Dr. Kai-Hui Song, who's a postdoctoral research associate at the Data-Driven EnviroLab. Okay, Kai-Hui, over to you.
Oh, thank you. So I'll present on behalf of Data-Driven Environment Lab, the team that works on the report to track the progress of the cities and some natural regions in the G20 countries towards their proposed targets and towards achieving 1.5 degree goal. So we have a couple of handouts in front of the door. If you're interested, please take one with you. And we also have a couple of stickers in case you're interested. So in this report, we compiled more than 10 different sources, including Net Zero Tracker, GCOM, ICLEI, et cetera, and target on the quantifiable targets. So as highlighted, we found that there's a big gap between the target setting and the progress that cities and subnational regions, they must have doubled their efforts to stay on track with their climate goals. There is some mess up. Okay, should be fine. So in September, this September, we released a report together with Utrecht University and CDP, NewClimate Institute, that evaluates the cities and regions' about their quantifiable climate targets from the G20 countries. And following a brief slump in the post-pandemic, subnational climate actions is beginning to rebound. There is an increase in the number of cities and the regions pledging the quantifiable emission reduction targets compared to last year, which is very positive. And there's a growing number of cities and regions that pledge net zero and carbon neutrality targets. As of 2022, 570 cities and regions are aiming for 100% emission reduction, carbon neutrality, and net zero targets, with one-third aimed at before and made of the by the mid of the century. And just under half of the cities and the regions with the net zero targets has interim reduction targets, which are an important indicator of credibility and robustness, mainly from these cities and the regions, mainly from the East Asia and the Pacific, specifically about Japan and North America. So cities and the subnational regions in the G20 countries together, they aim to reduce the emissions approximately 9 gigaton CO2 equivalent. We standardized to 2022 and by the year of 2060. The United States, China, Japan have been leading the emission reduction. Their regional emission reduction together account for still below about 20% to 40% of their national emissions, still below the having the emissions which is required to achieve the 1.5 degree goal. And in this report, following the target setting, we provide a snapshot of evaluating over 1,200 cities and over 100 regions in the G20 countries that disclose sufficient emission data to assess their progress towards their proposed targets as well as a 1.5 degree goal, which account for about over 1,500 targets together. We found that although more cities and the regions are reporting the needed data to evaluate the progress toward their own declared mitigation targets, the overall picture of the implementation remains still pretty weak. We found that less than 40% of the subnational governments are on track to achieve their goals. Notably, cities and regions in China, Canada, Australia, and Japan, that the countries that lead the most ambitious target setting are still only below 50% or even 25% of the targets are on track. And cities and the regions from the global south in particular lag in terms of the sufficient emission inventory data, for example, in China and some South Asian countries, where you don't have sufficient emission inventory to evaluate their progress. And cities and subnational regions need to wrap up the pace of the emission reduction to make up the lost ground and stay on track to achieve the targeted emission reduction goals. In this figure, we found there's an observable gap between the required pace of emission reduction and the actual progress made by the cities and the subnational regions. The majority, about 60% of the actors, are below the required annual reduction rate, which means there's an urgent need for them to increase their efforts to meet their self-declared climate goals. And in this histogram, it shows a distribution of annualized emission reduction, where the green lines show that they actually achieved an average of about 1.5% annual emission reduction. And for cities and subnational regions to the correct course to achieve their emission reduction targets, they need to double the pace of emission reduction to an average of around 3% per year. So we also analyze the cities and the regions, whether they are on track or not on track. For cities and regions that are not on track, they only reduce an average of 0.6% of annual reduction. And for those on track, there's an average of 3.6% of annual reduction. And even though the on-track states, the on-track cities and the regions are still making the progress below the required emission reduction to achieve the 1.5 degree goal, which requires 4% emission reduction per year. And currently, fewer than one-fifth of the target meet that, this threshold. There's another report where data-driven environment lab, also evolved its about the integrity matters. The integrity matters for cities, states, and the region, this report was produced through a collaboration of the global governor, governance of the mayors for climate energy and the WRI Center for Sustainable Cities. So there's an expert group comprising the select net zero initiatives, alliances, and partners institutes. They were get together in 2023 to explore the feasibility and applicability of the integrity matters and the recommendations to cities, states, and regions. And this report serves as a tailored and fit of purpose guide for all subnational governments and acknowledge their varied capacities and characteristics, and aims to provide a common global starting point for the settings and implementation of the ambitious, high integrity, transparent, credible, and fair net zero commitment by subnational governments. There are 20 contributing authors from all the major cities, regions, network, including C40, CDP, also our data-driven environment lab. And for example, there's a group, high-level expert group, allows the use of the high-integrity offsets, but this HLEG group for cities said they can't be used to demonstrate the progress towards emission reduction. If you are interested in this report, there's a link, or you can search just the name of the report and download for more details. And if you would like to know more about the progress tracking for the cities and the subnational regions, there's a barcode you can scan, and welcome to contact us. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Kaihui. Okay, so as we've heard, and actually is kind of common sense, there's quite a gap between an entity making a headline commitment and actually turning that into something that really, really drives emission reduction. So interesting to look particularly at the national level about what's actually needed. What is it that actually gets these emission reductions in place once the country's made the commitment? We're delighted to have with us Dr. Alina Averchenkova, who's a distinguished policy fellow leading on governance and regulation work at the Grantham Institute at London School of Economics in London. Fascinating paper that you've done on this, Alina. Please tell us all about it.
Thank you, Richard. And I'd like to go back to what Camilla has started us with, this credibility gap. So on one hand, we still have a long way to go in terms of getting more ambitious pledges. On the other hand, if we look at the current net zero commitments, I think about only 70 countries have integrated them in some form into the national climate governance systems. And we counted only 29 countries, including also region, European Union, which have integrated those commitments into their national legal frameworks through national climate legislation or regional in the case of the EU. And so the question we ask in this report that we just published at the Grantham Research Institute is, what drives political commitment by countries to net zero, but also what moves countries along what we call the net zero governance pathway, which is how do we get from the political commitment, say a pledge at the UNFCCC forum or in another political venue, to actual integration of net zero into national climate governance system and then implementation. And what is key in analyzing that, it's important to understand those pathways are not linear. And this maintaining political commitment actually is very important for all of the stages and becomes more difficult at the implementation as policies start to bite. So we've done our analysis based on looking at what is already available there in terms of the literature on net zero implementation across the globe. And we have also conducted two in-depth case studies on Spain and Fiji. And we deliberately picked two countries, one developed, one developing. Fiji, highly vulnerable to the impacts of climate change, small island, developing state. Yet both of these countries have taken net zero commitment and integrated it into the national climate governance system. And so based on the variety of studies plus the two case studies, we developed a framework which tries to understand what are the different drivers of the political commitment to net zero and how is that commitment being integrated. And what we find is that while every country has its unique pathway, depending on the national political, socioeconomic context, the drivers are pretty similar in very different contexts. So I just want to show you very briefly the findings from Fiji and Spain. This is based on the interviews, in-depth interviews with policy experts, government officials, NGOs and private sector in those two countries. And while they're very different, what we're finding actually, the dominant factor in both countries committing to net zero was the drive for international leadership and peer pressure. In the case of Fiji, as a small island, highly vulnerable developing state, they want to lead by example. They highlighted that to press for higher meters, to take commitments, they need to show that they're leading at home. So the international process and the Paris Agreement and also their role in the Pacific region was very important. For Spain, it's the Paris Agreement commitment, but also requirements from the European framework. So international process still has very high relevance, even though some of us get quite frustrated with it at times. Then secondly, the importance of economic opportunities. It had its own connotations. In Fiji, it's the opportunity to reduce reliance on fossil fuels and thereby also become more resilient to the impacts of climate change. I think they're dependent on 80% for the energy supply from imported diesel, while Spain, it was becoming the leader in the low-carbon technology markets. When we move to implementation of net zero commitments, what are the key determinants of that integration at the country level? And to understand that, we first looked at it from the climate governance perspective. This is based on the collaboration with scholars in South Africa and India we had last year, where we tried to identify what are the key governance functions that each country, regardless there they are, whether they're developing country or developed countries, there are some core functions that each country needs to put in place to be able to implement its net zero commitment. And those are the ones on this chart. So being able to set the strategy, engage stakeholders, mobilize finance, and so on. I won't go through all of them, horizontal mainstreaming and vertical integration. And we have then looked at the 26 countries that have already implemented net zero through their national climate laws and tried to understand what are countries currently focusing on in their legislation in terms of climate governance functions and where are the key gaps. What we find is that there is a lot of progress and focus on strategy setting and articulating long-term narrative. There's quite a lot of progress on that. However, there are gaps around and mechanisms to generate coordination and mainstreaming across sectors, as well as to ensure independent knowledge and advice for the government on climate policies, but also on carbon targets and implementation. And finally, I wanted to show you this, which is the analysis on Spain and Fiji. The left-hand column for both Fiji and Spain shows the assessment of what climate governance functions are addressed in their respective national climate laws. And green is strong and then red is weak. And what we notice is both climate laws are actually very comprehensive. If you look on paper, these are amazing, great climate laws. We can see what we would potentially want to see in them. However, when we talked and interviewed policy experts on the ground, what we find is that implementation actually is a challenge, and in particular, and again, the pillars are similar in both contexts, Spain and Fiji. So the challenges are around horizontal mainstreaming, climate into sectors, implementation across national and subnational levels, and also mobilizing finance. So for me, these are the key takeaways, that these are the areas that, as we are looking forward to the global stocktake and the next ratchet of NDCs, these are the areas that we definitely need to strengthen in terms of implementation at the national level. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks so much, Alina. Wonderful. Okay, so one of the things that's happened fairly recently in the net zero family is the establishment of the recognition and accountability framework within the UNFCCC. And sitting at the far end from me is the chap who's leading it, Todd Edwards. So many of you, if you work in this area, you'll know Todd already. And it'd be fascinating to get some views from you, Todd, about what's happening, where we're going, where you're up to, what issues you're looking at the moment. So, please.
Sure. Thanks, Richard. And congrats to everyone who's already presented. Absolutely amazing work. And it's been great working with a number of you on different projects over the years. So I will not have slides, and that actually reflects the current status of the recognition and accountability framework or consultation process because it's been extended. And so we were initially going to, it was anticipated that there would be recommendations coming out of that consultation process that's led by two co-chairs. That's Sarah Bloom Raskin, a professor of law at Duke University, and Bing Lang, a member of the ISSB. And when we started the process of the consultation, and I'll explain a bit more of what that process was, it was intended that, or expected that we would have some recommendations. But the consultation was so thorough and so much information came as it was a listening exercise that it really does take the proper time to absorb that information. And even though COP is the political moment for UNFCCC and for climate change, we don't want to be tied to just a political moment as a reason to publish something when we haven't actually quite absorbed it and maybe even need to go back out to the community to do more consultation. We expect now sometime in Q1 for those recommendations to come out from the consultation process. But I can say to date, there have been consultations with over 400 organizations, several dozen roundtable discussions with specific sectors, specific sets of stakeholders, many, many bilateral meetings, a full public town hall meeting, a survey that was sent out from the co-chairs, and a written submissions portal. And we heard Takeshi mention that there was a written submission from the consortium working on that particular report. So it has been extremely thorough, and it's been an independent process. So the co-chairs will report back to the executive secretary of the UNFCCC, Simon Steele, but they have been leading this process independent and with an ad hoc support team for throughout the duration. And so in that, it's truly a listening exercise, really wanting to hear what everyone has to say, their contributions around standards, amongst other things. And really honing in on what accountability means. What does integrity mean? And so I think that we will hopefully, as a collective community working on climate change, have much more clarity when we're thinking about trusted data, accountability, what integrity means, how can these different platforms like the Net Zero Tracker support efforts around accountability or around transparency. And so I would also like to take this opportunity to speak about a few other developments that are going to be happening next year. And in this, I also think that, you know, we're in a bit of a paradigm shift. We've seen a lot of conversations happening about, you know, what is quality climate action data, because we need that to have trust, right? What is accountability? What are the different roles of the different platforms that we've seen emerging? And, you know, one of the key players in all of this is also going through some transformations, and I can't speak for CDP, but CDP that's, does provide a lot of the data that we get for the different tools and platforms and analysis, they're also going through some transformations next year. There's the launch of the Net Zero Data Public Utility Proof of Concept that just happened here at COP. That's going to continue to be developed over this next year with the intention to be integrated into the Global Climate Action Portal of the UNFCCC upon the completion of the NZDPU. But the Global Climate Action Portal, GCAP, is also going to be going through redevelopment next year, and that would happen regardless of the consultation process. But the consultation process will affect it because it is on recommendation number 8 of the Integrity Matters Report, which is on tracking and accountability, and that all that information should land on the Global Climate Action Portal. So in this paradigm shift, it's also an opportunity to think about what else should we be considering as we redevelop these tools, as we refine our approaches. And that, I think that that's a maybe a rhetorical question, but an opportunity for comment from everyone who's here. And you can always reach us at the UNFCCC if you have thoughts around this. Because we're in this space where everything seems to be net zero, net zero, net zero. And that's okay. That's the current narrative. But tomorrow and a couple years down the line, we don't want to miss this opportunity where we're redeveloping GCAP or other tools and not include adaptation and resilience metrics, and not include ways that we see sector-specific commitments or ways that we can do analysis on systems transformations. And so I think it's a challenge for everyone here to think about how do we take this moment where net zero is the hot topic and we're doing these types of developments, how do we leverage this to make sure that 2 years from now we didn't miss something while in this process? And yeah, and I actually wouldn't mind if some of the panel, whenever they have answering some questions, you know, would reflect on that as well. And so, maybe I'll wrap up. I will just wrap up there. Thank you, Richard.
Great. Thank you so much, Todd. And just to say, we have one more speaker who I'm going to introduce in a sec, but after that, we would absolutely welcome your questions, your thoughts. We'll have about 40 minutes left for discussions. And Todd, anyone else that you want to ask, if you've got any comments, we're delighted to hear from you. I'm going to slip out of my seat now and welcome our final speaker, Emily Faint, who's the Net Zero Policy Lead at the British Standards Institute and has been very instrumental in the rollout of net zero guidelines globally. So, Emily, over to you.
Thank you, everyone. I hope you all enjoyed the long warm-up act for me. I will, I think, just sort of bring this panel to a close with just some points on implementation of everything my co-panelists have set out so brilliantly. So we know the points about the gap between pledges and action, the integrity gap, some of the instruments that we need to mobilize to actually address that in practice. What I'll be speaking to you all about today is the role of recognized international standards, because as was aptly put up by the Net Zero Tracker and the report on the screen, we are seeing strong convergence around what good looks like for key tenants of net zero. That was sort of beautifully set out by the UN Secretary General's high-level expert group at COP27 last year, and barely a week later was also found to be replicated and embedded in the ISO net zero guidelines, which is a deliverable that Rich has very kindly mentioned earlier. Now, the key thing about that column you saw earlier, the five different providers of guidance that said what good net zero looks like, is only one of them actually reflected an international standard setter. And that is the system that is comprised of sort of ISO, IEC, ITU, the formal and often lesser understood international standard system that is recognized by the World Trade Organization. And the reason why that matters is because the World Trade Organization is set up to prevent technical barriers to trade and to prevent tensions and to ensure easy economic cooperation. So international standards that do not reflect the criteria that we are all calling for here today will not actually scale across the global economy. And I don't know about you, but I don't think I want to have too many more COPs where we talk about fragmented governance. I want to start seeing that genuine convergence and that genuine harmonization. But there is good news here. The first is, as has been set out, convergence is happening around what good net zero looks like. And so the fantastic work led by many of the voluntary initiatives and NGOs in this space to achieve that convergence means we may now be in the right time to actually standardize it. Now, the ISO Net Zero Guidelines represents the mainstreaming of all of the criteria that you see from well-known organizations such as SBTI, CDP, the Greenhouse Gas Protocol, ICVCM, and many others mentioned today, into that international standard system for the first time, and actually defining net zero for the first time, which sounds like a technical detail, but it's actually an incredibly important step forward, and I think it's good to celebrate positive step forwards and wins at COP. However, that's not the end of the story. We need to scale this further across the global economy, and we also need to make sure that the entire international standard system comes with it. And one development that many of you may not know about, but I think is a really exciting story in this story of convergence, is something called the London Declaration, or otherwise known as the ISO Climate Commitment. Now, what this is a commitment to look at the entire portfolio of recognized international standards. There's over 25,000. And all of the national standards that sit beneath them, and revise them all in line with the Paris Agreement. Now, that is an enormous commitment, an enormous undertaking, and something that is happening in every national standards body in the world. By the way, there are 170, and if you don't know yours, I strongly encourage you to look them up by the end of this panel. If you're in the UK, it is us at BSI. I'm very happy to have conversations and cars after the event. And so the London Declaration and the development of the ISO Net Zero Guidelines and next steps beyond that represent sort of what was well set out earlier, I think, in terms of vertical and horizontal mainstreaming. So we need to tackle every individual standard across sectoral action, but we also need to make sure that the concept of net zero itself is reflected in the international standard system and scaled across every country in the world. That seems quite a simple thing, and you may think I'm forgetting about the points that have been raised around accountability and quality. So the international standard system represents a pillar of what we call global quality infrastructure, which is a very jargony way of saying the system that we all live in day to day and already trust to give us goods, services, and products that we use every day. So if you are using a laptop in this room, as I see many of you are, that laptop is predicated on 200 plus standards to build both the software and the hardware and make sure that that laptop can be produced, manufactured, and exported easily wherever you may be purchasing laptops. If you went to a restaurant today and you put food in your mouth, trusting implicitly that it wouldn't make you sick, and you didn't ask them to tell you where it had come from and who made it and who cooked it, you trust standards and you trust that global quality infrastructure I'm referring to that consists of standards, accreditation bodies, the people that say you are competent, you definitely know what you're talking about, you can go and check compliance, and conformity assessment bodies, i.e. the people whose jobs it is to go out and check compliance with standards. If we think about how many companies there are in the world that we ultimately want to be scaling to net zero, how many people do you think it will take to check that they're all compliant with net zero at the pace we need to reach the Paris Agreement? That is a lot of people for a lot of NGOs to hire. Or we could scale it through the international standard system and unlock that existing accountability structure that global quality infrastructure offers. So that's a key message that I want to reflect here to make sure that all of you know. One, these developments are happening. There are good news stories. Please do follow them. And two, to let you know that it isn't happening without you, but it could if you don't engage going forward. many of you are leading climate action solution providers, whether you sit in NGOs or whether you sit in leading businesses, or indeed if you are a policymaker in government. International standards are designed to reflect global consensus, and that consensus reflects who is writing them. So if you are a high integrity climate actor and you are not involved in the development of recognized international climate standards, I urge you to get in touch with your national standards body and apply to join your national climate standards committee, because that is how we can really, really drive this final next stage of convergence and ensure that the recognized standards that underpin the global economy reflect the integrity that each of my co-panelists have been calling for. I'll stop there.
Lovely. Well, thanks very much to all of our speakers. So we have about 40 minutes left, as I hoped we would. So this is your time. What do you want to ask? What comments do you have? We will have a roving microphone coming round. So if you've got a question or a comment, please just put up your hand and the microphone will come round your way. And if nobody has one, I'm going to exercise chair. Yeah, gentleman over there. Yes, absolutely. Second row back, please. Microphone's coming your way. Please say who you are and where you're from, please.
Hello. Is it working? Okay. Hello. My name is Shay Turner Matthews. I'm a student at College of the Atlantic studying kind of the intersection between data science and climate justice. And I was, first of all, I'd like to thank all of you, and I think what the work you're doing is pretty incredible. And I'm wondering if there's like other methods of quantifying or climate action that might not be net zero targets. For example, maybe like biodiversity protection or oil extraction, and if that's something you're looking into. And then I was also wondering if there are plans to, once there's kind of a solid base, to incorporate more interdisciplinarity into these data sets, perhaps in the form of like social justice data and stuff like that. So yeah, open question to anyone.
Wonderful, thank you. Both very interesting questions. Takeshi, especially seeing as you're involved with the climate action tracker, would you like to speak to the first of those questions, perhaps, about different ways of evaluating climate progress? And then, Camilla, I wonder if you'd like to speak to the second, because the elements of social justice, for example, is in HLEG, so that's something we've been talking about within the tracker, about how we can integrate that. So maybe Takeshi first.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for your question. In the non-state climate action integrity assessments, this biodiversity and these other environmental factors, other societal dimensions are often not considered, or we just do not have the capacity yet to link this climate change mitigation dimensions to other important societal and economic dimensions. On the national level, for example, the Climate Action Tracker project does look into other environmental considerations and also the fairness and the justice dimensions. And that's partly because the equity and fairness has been a long-standing issue since the beginning of the UNFCCC process. So that area has been fairly well developed in terms of research and also engagement with the policymakers and stakeholders. But that itself, getting it right analytically and communicating in a political context and negotiations is very challenging. And even to this date, we struggle. There's no right answer to it, and it's always trial and error for us.
Thanks. Camilla?
Yeah, I think just to build on what Takeshi said, at the Net Zero Tracker, we include equity as one of the metrics as to how robust a net zero target is. But as Takeshi said, it's very difficult to get right, because equity can mean a number of different things, right? At a national level, it could be whether or not you are like Sweden, you've brought your net zero target forward in time to account for the fact that giving other nations time to develop, I don't like the word develop, but to develop at the same time. But it could also mean equity within your country. Are you thinking about a just transition like South Africa, for example? So to get that right is really tricky, and it's something that we're actively thinking about at the Net Zero Tracker, because it is really, really important.
So. Takeshi, do you want to come back on that, and then Alina?
Just to add, so where, for example, like biodiversity and this climate change mitigation crosses over is nature-based solutions, for example. Now there are a lot of discussions about nature-based solutions or the carbon dioxide removal through land use-based solutions. And that area is gaining more and more attention, and we are paying a lot of attention, not only the Net Zero Tracker project, but also in Climate Action Tracker and many other sort of research and analytical activities, and we're communicating that very proactively in the UNFCCC process and many other channels.
And Alina.
I just wanted to add there is quite a lot of interest in developments now using artificial intelligence and machine learning techniques as well. At the Grantham Research Institute, we have the database, which is called a resource, Climate Laws of the World, which searches policies and laws from all around the world that address climate change or are related to climate. And for a partnership with Climate Policy Radar, we are now applying machine learning techniques, which allow you to search within the texts of national policies and laws themselves in different languages. And one of the projects we're looking at this year, well, the coming year, is actually understanding better just transition dimension. So we will be trying to extract just transition related information and trying to analyze what are different countries putting into their national policies and legislation in that respect. But there are other projects which look at other aspects of that as well.
Great, thank you for your questions. Very interesting. Okay, at the back, please, over in the middle, if you could give it to the gentleman right at the back. I said it there. Yep.
Kurt Winter from the Carbon Market Institute in Australia. Couple of questions. One is around the temporal dimension of net zero and the evolving science on a credible 1.5 degree pathway. Interested to hear your thoughts on how these best practice standards can appropriately account for that, given that the science is increasingly, the window is narrowing, I guess. And then a second question, you mentioned nature-based solutions. We've obviously also had the significant nature positive paradigm come to the fore with the Montreal Treaty. Interested to know how flexible some of these guidelines might be to support corporate claims in that respect as well.
Oh, sorry, just to clarify, when you talk about the temporal dimension, yep. Do you mean, for example, the delay between carbon being emitted and carbon being reabsorbed, that sort of thing?
More in terms of what's credible in terms of the final destination of net zero and the potential need to move that forward from a 2050 commitment to much earlier in a company's outlook.
Okay, great. I'm sure many of you could have a go at this, but Todd, I wonder if you've got any thoughts on this. I'm interested also whether it's the sort of thing that's cropped up during the discussions you've been having.
I can provide some thoughts. Maybe I'll also put a disclaimer out there that the UNFCCC, and especially on the team that I lead on tracking and recognition, do not specify what a particular actor should be doing, but we track it and we recognize it. However, being involved previously with the expert peer review group for East to Zero and other things that I have done in this space, this has come up in conversation as far as like, well, what's a credible interim target, and when should an actor be net zero? Again, I'm going to be speaking from the non-party stakeholder side, so this does not involve my response is not about national governments, but it's subnationals are this example is much easier to tell with subnationals. So the global north cities, for example. If they have an interim target having emissions by 2030, and then net zero by 2050, and they're part of an initiative that also includes global south cities, should global south cities also have the same thing, or what is actually the equitable share? And many would argue that global north cities need to probably have a stronger interim target
and aim to reach net zero before 2050. Because whenever you blend the actual initiative, the initiative itself should be at the halving emissions by 2030 and net zero by 2050. And perhaps science could argue that all initiatives should be having net zero before 2050. But that's, I'll leave that to colleagues up here to talk about.
Emily, how are you addressing these issues of equity and so on, and who should get to net zero when, and nature-based solutions? How are you dealing with them?
Yeah, no, thank you. I mean, I think I Todd sort of said many of the key points I was going to make, but I think if I reflect on the development of the ISO net zero guidelines, which is the first ISO deliverable, as I mentioned earlier, to define net zero, but also crucially for this question, contain an entire clause focused on equity, just transition, and fair share considerations. Standardization can only reflect what consensus is and what we all agree on. And so a lot of the language that you'll find in there is very much about some of the points Todd mentioned. So that there are some actors that should be aiming to get to net zero before 2050, because there will be others that have capacity issues and will need additional support from others and may get there later. Ultimately, we're trying to reach a global net zero threshold and limit warming to 1.5 and well below 2. So the pathway for different actor types in different places in the world will look slightly different. From a standardization perspective, unless any of you can pull out of the bag a perfect quantifiable methodology for fair share transitions that you could come and talk to me about afterwards, the furthest we can go in standardization is standardize a consideration that if you are an organization with greater resources, greater historical responsibility, and greater capacity to act, it is your responsibility to be going further and faster to help reach net zero sooner and help others who may struggle with their own resources get there too. But you won't find criteria in there that you've never seen anywhere else, because again, we have to reflect consensus and standards for it to be scalable. So I'm really excited to see how research develops in this just transition and fair share space, because ultimately where we land on that will be how we can embed verifiable fair share considerations into organizational level standards. That, I think, would be the really big win.
Alina, I'd just like to ask you something which is very connected to this question. A lot of countries have a standard set 2050 for their net zero dates. The UN Secretary General fairly recently has asked advanced economies basically to be looking at 2045. Based on the work that you've been looking at, the kind of factors that move countries forward, what would you say about the prospects of advanced economies, thinking the EU, for example, the US, of advancing their 2050 dates?
Richard, that's a challenging question. We haven't assessed the likelihood of countries achieving their 2050 targets per se, but what we did discover in our assessment of how ready countries are on the governance side to meet their targets, one of the big challenges which came up again across the board along developed and developing countries, that a lot of commitments to net zero have been taken before there was actually a credible analysis in place at the national level of how to achieve that target. So in a sense, politics went ahead of the reality on the ground in terms of actually having credible scenarios. And then the order basically comes down to the relevant government departments that now we need to find pathways. And a few countries we have looked at, they are either in the process of developing those pathways, so they've got them outlined. Now the challenge is to what extent they can actually be implemented. And I think in a number of cases, countries will struggle. But for me, it's really worrying that that gap, that we actually get commitment before we know whether we can get there. And I think that's something that one should look into and support countries that still don't have that analysis in place.
Yes, and Todd, have you got to leave now? Thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate having you on the panel. Thank you very much. I just wanted to pick up that element with Kaihui as well, if that's okay, because I wonder if the same is true with some of the cities and subnationals that you've been looking at, that they set a target and then they've basically had to think, oh, okay, how on earth are we going to meet that? What does it actually mean? And maybe that's one of the reasons why some of the
the implementation actually isn't really happening at the rates one might like?
Thanks for the question. It's a great question. In our assessment, we only assess the quantifiable climate targets, which means the quantifiable means they have a specific target year, target emission year, and also emission inventory. So these are the criteria for us to assess their progress. However, we also noticed that there are a lot of cities and subnational governments, while they have some climate action policies, and those policies are not have enough data for us to evaluate. And for example, some cities with net zero targets, for example, by 2050, but they, for the example, half of them approximately do not have interim targets for us to assess whether they are on track to achieve their net zero targets or not. So there's a lot of challenge in assessing their progress towards their proposed climate goals.
Yeah, it's an interesting one, isn't it? Years ago, I had a chat with Lord Michael Howard, who was the UK Environment Secretary at the time of the Rio Convention. So he was responsible, along with the Prime Minister, for signing the Rio Convention. And he, you know, his view was that we didn't really know how we were going to cut emissions, and we didn't really know how much it was going to cost, but we knew we had to do it, so we made the commitment anyway. And I guess the fact that if you don't make the commitment, then you maybe never do the work to find out what you have to do. Anyway, Takeshi, did you want to come in on that, or we just...
Yeah, okay, great. Happy to. So with a different hat as a Japanese climate policy researcher here. so Japan's NDC is a 46% reduction from 2013 levels by 2030. And when they committed to this target, actually they didn't expect to actually submit that number. What they had in the pocket, you know, in respective ministries, was somewhere around 30-ish percent to 40%. But they decided to go higher, partly due to external pressure to go more ambitious. And in Japan, the target setting process was always been bottom up. So considering many like energy security issues and feasibility, etc., the costs. So they never went out of the box. They always went with the target levels that are somewhat manageable, but never really ambitious, you know, in the light of Paris Agreement's goals. But this time they really went out of the box and really went, you know, into the ocean. And so they still do not have official emission scenario towards net zero, and also with also achieving NDC's got a whole trajectory towards 2050. But because of this ambitious target, they now can think about, you know, having higher renewable energy targets. And in fact, they have already went far beyond what they have committed under the previous NDC target, which was 26% only. So once you have the target, it kind of stimulates your thinking and ideas. So there is a positive aspect to having these ambitious targets too.
Lovely, thank you very much. So another couple of questions or comments over here. I'll take the lady in the second row first, please, and then we'll take the lady in the fourth row. So.
Thank you. Building on this point, which has just been discussed, for both regions, cities, states, and corporates, do you see the possibility that we could develop a language which says, in which they say, this is the climate commitment we want to make, this is what we know we can do, and there is an innovation and implementation gap that we all need to sort out together in the middle. So you're almost getting people making two different commitments. One is, we know we can do this, and it's all mapped out, and we have all the figures. The other is, actually, our just and equitable contribution to this is this, but we acknowledge we have a gap. And that's innovation and implementation.
So just to clarify, would this be, for example, analogous to the conditional NDCs that some developing countries...
That's a very good, that's a very good analogy. I would agree.
Okay, great. Who would like to pick that up? Very interesting question. Who'd like to pick that one up? If not, I'm going to pick on someone. Alina, what do you think?
Well, I think, as Richard, you already started mentioning, it depends which country context we're talking about, and also, what would be the purpose of that additional kind of contribution based on innovation? And I'll explain what I mean. If we think about the context of developed countries, I think one would need to be careful to ensure that this kind of additional contribution that might be possible relying on negative technologies or some innovation which might potentially come, that does not become as a way to take the pressure off in terms of using the technologies which are already available and the policy tools which are already available to reduce emissions in the meanwhile. So I think it's a very interesting idea, but I'd like to discuss a bit more what you would have in mind. In terms of developing country context, I think effectively conditional NDCs is what kind of goes to that. Developing countries outline, we can do more provided we get financial support and we get also access to technology and capacity building. I'm interested if anyone has a different view here.
It strikes me that this is maybe an issue for some subnationals, particularly cities as well, because they can set the most ambitious goal that they want, but actually, to a large extent, they are dependent then on what their national government says. What do you think, Kaihui? Is there a role here where, you know, a city could say, yes, we want to do this, but we actually need this from you, please, national government?
Oh, yeah, for sure. There are definitely some different nations adopted different approaches. Some definitely have a top-down approach where there's a NDC and subnational regions and cities started to implement and develop more detailed city-level action plans to implement these targets. While other nations, the first top-down is Malay, for example, the country, for example, China. And there are other countries develop more bottom-up approach where the subnational governments started some documents and takes a leadership that drives up the NDC. Definitely there are different approaches between different nations. Also for the cities, I would say it's a very difficult question for cities because there's a supply chain, for example, different accounting approach, whether they are responsible for their territorial emissions, whether they have control over the emissions that occurred from the outside of the world, from other cities, other countries. So there's a lot of ambiguity involved in that that caused a difficulty for cities to develop more actionable items to mitigate their emissions.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to take a question from another question from over here, please, if we may.
Thank you. So I'm Siobhan. I'm a student at Oxford studying sustainability. So in net zero pledges by governments and corporates, there's always some element of CDR, carbon dioxide removal. And there's a lot of criticism that sort of near-term targets emit higher than normal because they over-rely on future CDR, which has a lot of uncertainty technologically, but there's also legal uncertainty and social uncertainties around it. And I guess the context and why I'm asking this question, and the question is, what is the over-reliance on CDR and how do you measure that? Is there a framework? When you do your analysis of emissions gaps, like how do you know how much CDR is okay and how much is an over-reliance? And sorry, the context is I'm a lawyer and I do see a wave of climate litigation coming in that kind of argues that the over-reliance of CDR is contrary to domestic laws, to probably even human rights, but how would courts kind of assess that if it's not being done or is it being done, I guess?
Yeah, this is something that we've talked a lot about within the Net Zero Tracker Consortium. Camilla, what do you think? I mean, clearly there's a capacity issue in terms of tracking this stuff, isn't there? But then there's this conceptual issue of how you deal with this, deal with it as well.
Yeah, thanks, Richard. It's a great question. Something that's a live question at the Net Zero Tracker, actually, because we're trying to think about how to track it better. And so the two parts to your question. The first is kind of what is this, you know, what should the standard be? And of course, it's dependent on sector, right? Some sectors like aviation are very difficult to decarbonize. And so we might be more willing to allow CDR there rather than, for example, fashion. So we don't set a hard target for that, but we kind of look at what the entity is saying about carbon dioxide removal. And we will be collecting, going forward, the percentage emission reduction that each entity has committed to, and that's an effort to capture this, whether or not there is going to be an over-reliance on CDR, because at present we only capture, right, whether they have a net zero target in the future, and then interim we might look at whether they have emissions reduction. But now we're going to be thinking a bit more broadly than that, to really think about whether it's a real net zero. Yeah.
Emily, would you like to answer?
Yeah, and if I could just come in with a couple of points on that as well. I think it's also about, again, the role of clarifying between reductions and removals and making sure that that emphasis on deep emissions reductions remains clear in all net zero strategies and, of course, reflected in the standards that follow. I think probably in the removal space, there are many others better qualified than I to speak to this, but one of the key tensions we have to manage is obviously the as you say, the feasibility and scalability of these technologies, the credibility of the role of removals with good net zero, but also making sure the standards that are developed around that don't stifle the urgently needed investment now to scale high quality, well-governed removals in the market, so that by the time we are approaching our net zero target date, there is actually the capacity in the removal market to deliver on that net zero in a credible way that we can all claim. So that, as Camilla said, is very much a live debate, but I think that the key thing here is just making sure that we're clarifying that distinction between reductions and removals, and we don't see them conflated or misused, as is we are seeing quite prominently in many national government strategies as well as organisational ones. So I don't have a good answer for you, but I think those distinctions are really key.
Yeah. Thank you so much. It's an excellent question, and I think this is going to remain a live and active issue for quite some time, to be quite frank. Okay, another question down the front. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Marco. I work on international climate finance in the UK government. So first of all, thank you for your work. I think this is super important, and it's, you know, very relevant to look at the detail behind big headlines that sometimes we come across, you know, during COPs or even United Nations General Assembly. So personally, I've been quite critical of very doom and gloom narratives, you know, saying we're heading towards, you know, catastrophic future, because I do see that there is some great work being done. Having said that, the presentation I've heard from all of you gave me good empirical evidence that indeed this doom and gloom can be supported. You know, we're not getting there yet. More work needs to be done. So I think this is more of a general question to the panel as of what do you see as, you know, any potential positives in all of this? You mentioned, Emily, the convergence and some of the work. So there is a step forward. Definitely more needs to be done, but I wanted to pick your brains a bit on, is there anything that can make me, Marco, more hopeful about the future?
Okay, that's our mission for the next 5 minutes. Make Marco hopeful. I like that. Who'd like to have a first go at that? Well, yeah, okay, Alina, yeah, over to you.
Well, I think maybe sharing Fiji's story that I mentioned. I think, and that's also, unfortunately, Todd is not with us anymore, but I also wanted to pick up his challenge on how does that link also net zero to adaptation. I think what we found in Fiji is that ambitious commitment, which will be quite hard for them to meet, to net zero, actually is creating new ways for the government to work together. They are creating capacity in the key, they have already created capacity in the key ministries to address climate change. And net zero is creating an opportunity for them to raise finance and to address resilience in a better way. And I hope it's not only Fiji's story, it's hopefully across many other countries. If we look at kind of economic opportunity story that I've mentioned, there are signs, I think there is plenty of data in terms of renewables, the investment growing and the costs falling, but if we look at the specific countries, I think there are clear signs that there are shifts in the economy. Maybe not as fast as we would like it to happen, but I think there is plenty of evidence that individual countries, but also sectors globally, are shifting to where we need them to think. But most importantly for me, it's this governance innovation and new ways of working. I think what the panel before talked about, even if net zero sometimes in many cases might be not very realistic yet, it is creating and kind of pushing different actors to work in a different way, and that leads to innovation and hopefully will speed up the transition.
Okay. Emily, do you want to have a go at that? You were fairly optimistic earlier on.
Yes, especially because I used to work in the UK government, so I'm incredibly sympathetic to the points that you've raised. I think the good news stories are that, again, it's the convergence, as you've noted, it's becoming clearer and clearer what good looks like, which makes the ability to undermine or delay harder and harder. I think a lot of work is being done to piece together these different critical aspects of net zero action and reframe it as the journey it is. So there's examples of that, not just from the ISO world, with the ISO net zero guidelines and the announcement earlier this week that ISO and IFRS are committed to closer working to drive interoperability between those two standards bodies. But also, we've seen the end-to-end integrity framework announcement this week about SBTI, Greenhouse Gas Protocol, ICBCM and BCMI, sort of connecting together in a clearer pathway for organizations to follow. So movement is happening, but it just takes a moment before we feel it in the market. And I think from a government perspective as well, if the non-state actors that you are overseeing are collaborating more and more closely and joining up more and more closely, it also gives governments and policymakers and regulators greater confidence to start to make some of this criteria mandatory. So the UK government's obviously welcomed the adoption of the ISSB standards, as have many other jurisdictions. But if we think back to 5 years ago, the idea of making mandatory emissions reporting for companies, it would have been, you would have been called crazy, throw out the room, you'll make too much burden for business, we couldn't possibly consider emissions reporting this important. And here we are. So I think if that's the traction and the momentum that we're seeing now, where will we be in 2 years, say by COP30, which many are already talking about as the next big COP and drive of momentum. So I think there's a lot to be hopeful for, but just make sure that we don't let go of the rigor that a lot of the data sets and the work of the Net Zero Tracker show us as well.
Camilla, have you got a reason for optimism bubbling?
I am unabashedly enthused about the future. Part of that is because there are hundreds of people across the world who volunteer with the Net Zero Tracker, and it's amazing to me that people around the world give up their time to stop climate change, and just being at COP, there's so many people here talking about climate change. Isn't that cool? But also, kind of in terms of the data, we've just gone over 1,000 of the Forbes 2,000 biggest publicly listed companies who've set a net zero target. I spend too much of my time looking at net zero targets, and I consistently see people strengthening their targets. As I mentioned, we've seen nations go from having a kind of a proposed thing to in policy to in law. So there is movement. My mother knows what net zero is. I mean, if my mother knows, we're really doing
that's
great
the
things.
Real test. Does your mum know what net zero is, guys?
Yes. Just moving from ABBA, Does Your Mother Know, to a band that probably was less famous, Ian Dury and the Blockheads, who had a hit back in the, when I was young, so it's about contemporary with Beethoven. Reasons to be cheerful, 1, 2, 3. So I'll give you 1, 2, 3 reasons to be cheerful. One, loss and damage has gone from nowhere 2 years ago to a real thing. Secondly, emissions peaking is actually within reach within the next year or two. Power sector emissions may already have peaked already. The third one, look at where oil and gas companies are putting these windfall profits that they've made. They're all talking big about expansion, but if you look at the amount of money they're actually putting into exploration and development, those sums are shrinking massively, very quickly. They're sending it all back to their shareholders. So there you are, 1, 2, 3, reasons to be cheerful. We've probably got time for like one more question or observation. Yes, absolutely. Please.
Thank you very much. I'm Céline Kaufman, working at IDRI, which is a policy think tank based in Paris. My question is related to the last discussion and to ask all the panels, actually, if you through the monitoring and tracking exercise, if you have a sense of the penetration of these net zero pledges commitments in different business populations. You've talked about big companies, but what do you know about the SMEs and the leverage effect that it has on different parts of businesses?
Takeshi, is that one you can take on? You probably know a bit more about this in detail than anyone else on the panel, I think. Okay, let's move the microphone over to CDP then, please. Give us your name so we know where you're from.
I'm Emil Sokolovsky, I'm from CDP.
Right.
Sorry, it's weird because you asked a question that we answer directly.
Go for it.
Most of the CDP has 24,000 reporters, 68% of global market capitalization. Most of them are SMEs. And actually, one of our biggest programs is the supply chain program. And the response rate to supply chain program, i.e. obvious supplies, is consistently going up. Now, it's going to sound like a small number, and I ask no one to quote it because I can't remember, because it came out yesterday and I can't remember the precise ending of it. But in the last 3 years, the response of small companies, I'm not talking large, which is much, much higher, has gone from, I think, 29% to 43%. It's not huge, but it's a leap of their capacity to do so. There are two initiatives in addition to us who have an SME questionnaire that are doing this. They come to us increasingly. The ISSB has created a capacity building hub, which itself will help SMEs, and so on and so forth, and so on and so forth. And I just wanted to add for Marco that the IEA report, actually, which was sort of mentioned, is the peaking in 2030 is something that they said. We're not saying if it's good or bad. We're just saying financially it's inevitable. Now, whether they're right or wrong, that is the first time that that was said. That in itself, as you mentioned.
And I think that's going to turn out to be very pessimistic. Emily, I wanted just a quick word from you, because the standards that you have, right, you mentioned restaurant standards. So standards are applicable, presumably, to a one-family restaurant as they are to, like, a massive chain. So the net zero work, is that as applicable to a small enterprise as it is to a corporate giant, to an IKEA and a Microsoft, for example, or not?
Yeah, so the question of SME applicability is something that we talk about a lot, as you can imagine. A lot of the criteria that's been identified that reflects what good looks like for net zero definitely is more applicable to larger organizations. There's
right.
No getting away from that. However, we have to think about it again as the full journey and think about the full value chain of these big companies. So if we take a UK context, I'm probably going to get this percentage wrong, forgive me, but something like over 95% of UK businesses are SMEs. So if we have mandatory reporting standards for emissions disclosures covering scope 3 for those big companies, that means that those SMEs in those supply chains have to play a crucial role. Now, the capacity building needed to help those SMEs to deliver on that data reporting is obviously a really important next step. But actually, we don't have to think about standards being directly applicable to SMEs only as the way in which SMEs are engaged. I mean, just as an anecdotal example, from a BSI perspective, we do try to offer tools and products that help situate these standards in a way that is easier for SMEs to implement. So there is, for example, the Little Book of Net Zero. We also have tools featured on the SME Climate Hub, and we try to actively talk to these organizations that are dedicated to making this guidance and best practice applicable to SMEs. Mm. So there is even a discussion about whether there needs to be a specific standard just for SMEs on net zero. But I think, again, we want to make sure that we're not causing further fragmentation to the system, and that we're thinking about what asks are we already putting on SMEs by applying these standards to large companies.
Very interesting. Okay, well, unless any of the panelists have got any very final brief comments, I'm going to bring things to a close then, because I've literally can see the clock ticking there, and we've got 1 minute and 3 seconds left. So unless anyone has got some final thoughts they want to bung in.
Join your national standards body climate committees, please. ISO.org/members, whichever country you're in, please do get in touch with them and ask how you can contribute to international standards development on climate.
Wonderful.
And now I'm done.
Thank you. And Camilla, I guess you'd say any students out there who want or are interested in this and want a profitable way of spending their time, contact you, sign up
please
to
do.
Be a volunteer accreditor.
Okay. Exactly.
Fantastic. Well, let me just thank the rest of the panel then. Emily Faint, Camilla Hislop, Dr. Takeshi Kuramochi, Dr. Kai Hui Song, Dr. Alina Averchenkova, and Todd Edwards, who's no longer right here. And I also need to thank a couple more people for organizing it. John Lang, who does so much of the work here, leading the Net Zero Tracker, and Nick Hay, who did an awful lot to, who I can't see right now, but he did an awful lot to organize this particular event. So enjoy the rest of COP. See you.